Hello, dear fans, friends, and subscribers. Welcome to this daily cricket show, this on a Sunday with your host Ram. Well, dear fans, friends, subscribers, I know that yesterday's cricket show was a bit short, but I also did some experiment over there by actually getting on to the 3D mode. I know the picture quality would have been a bit distorted because I was just doing a sort of an experimentation yesterday. To see how the 3D image looks on this particular cricket show, thanks to YouTube. But, well, I think it really didn't come off well, but I will be doing my experiments as far as making my cricket show a 3D cricket show, as and when, you know, if there are not much international matches to cover, like yesterday, I had to just talk about briefly, so that's the reason I experimented. I know some people might have not liked it, because the picture quality was a bit distorted, but it's just a matter of experimentation. So please bear with me here, dear fans, friends, and subscribers. Well, you've been a good bunch of guys, dear friends, subscribers, always subscribing to my cricket show, offering me all the support that is needed for this daily cricket show to be a great success in the future. Well, so what I'm going to start off with today, what I have on the plate for you today, this on a Sunday on this cricket happening show, is two matches. One is the third day's play between Sri Lanka and Pakistan, where Sri Lanka pretty much looking to be in a, I wouldn't say, the match is looking well poised for a result, and why not? This is the decider of this particular test series, with both the teams locking horns at 1-1. So this is the final test match, the decider, and it all boils down to who is going to win this match. But right now, it's very difficult to say something, but Sri Lanka are looking strong here. 291 runs in the lead after picking up the last wicket of Pakistan pretty early today. So Sri Lanka are 291 runs ahead right now. So it's very difficult to say anything right now, but I think the match is in the balance right now. But going to the fourth day, but we are definitely going to have a result. And what a series this has been between Pakistan and Sri Lanka. So I'll be talking about that. And the other thing that we were all eagerly looking forward to was the first T20 match of the series, which started between Bangladesh and South Africa, because Bangladesh had the newfound confidence. But today, even though South Africa had their second string pace attack here, of the absence of Dale Steyn, Vernon Philander, and Monnie Morkel, their pace aces, in fact, I thought South Africa did a good start here by actually registering a very comfortable victory, one could say, in the end, as Bangladesh were bowled out for the lowest ever total in a T20 match at home here, when Bangladesh were rolled out for 96 after South Africa on a very, very difficult pitch, one could say, where the spinners were the one who were really doing well. There was a slow pitch, the ball was not really coming out of bat, you had to really, really stay at the wicket. There were some balls from the spinners which were also keeping low. So it was a pretty difficult pitch to bat on, but South Africa stood the test well by scoring 148 and then rolled out the Bangladeshis for 96. So South Africa having a good start to their campaign against Bangladesh. Well, but first let me get on to this match between Sri Lanka and Pakistan. So as I said, Sri Lanka and Pakistan were today, it was something that was what one was waiting for. Today was the third day's play, and Pakistan last wicket was in the pan. As I was telling you yesterday, it was very essential that Sarfraz Ahmed could take the crease, but unfortunately that was not to be. But I thought the Sri Lankan bowlers did a pretty good work, in the sense they saw to it that Pakistan wouldn't be able to reach the total of what Sri Lanka had set in the first innings by bowling them out for 215, when Imran Khan was struggling with his batting, was clean bowled by Tarindu Kaushal for naught, leaving Sarfraz Ahmed not out on 78 with 6-4. So that enabled enabled Sri Lankans to get a 63-run lead going into the second innings. The bowling, well, I can only say about Tarindu Kaushal, who took the wickets. He had his bag of 3 for 37. Now, Sri Lanka, in their second deck, 63 runs ahead, were really rocked today. I thought the pace bowlers, Rahat Ali, Ehsan Adil, and Imran Khan, all the three bowlers, were really, really putting a very, were bowling a very, very good line. And what was interesting to see is that Rahat Ali was absolutely on the mark. The other day we saw Imran Khan bowling superbly, but today it was Rahat Ali, absolutely, because he was swinging the ball beautifully outside the off stump and also getting the ball to get in. He was showing a lot of pace variations, and he was really keeping the batsman guessing. He was beating the bat of the Sri Lankan batsman quite often. And then finally, Rahat Ali was rewarded. Ehsan Adil was also doing a good job at the other end, bowling in tandem with Rahat Ali. And the first wicket to go as a breakthrough was provided by Rahat Ali, as Karna Ratne was scalped by first Rahat Ali bowled a good line. He really tested him outside the off stump, and then finally produced a toe-crushing yorker to shatter the stumps of Karna Ratne. And Karna Ratne gone, bowled Rahat Ali for 10, which made the score 12 for 1. And then Kaushal Silva at the other end was along with Upul Tharanga. And that was the time Ehsan Adil was also bowling in the good areas, but Rahat Ali was the one who was impressive, who was quite impressive. And then Ehsan Adil, it was Ehsan Adil's turn to pick up the second wicket of the Sri Lankans, as Sri Lanka lost the wicket. Kaushal Silva, as we know, he's such a wonderful player in the sense he really, really plays the ball with soft hands. And today, even Kaushal Silva couldn't keep out Ehsan Adil, as a ball that nicked the outside edge of the bat of Kaushal Silva and missed Baul Haq and the slips, made no mistake. So he was gone for 3. The score read 22 for 2. And Lairu Thirumane, once again, as I said, Rahat Ali was bowling superbly. In fact, it was Lairu Thirumane who got a toe crusher from Rahat Ali as he was gone for a blob. And suddenly the Sri Lankan innings were looking at a ragged score at 35 for 3. And Sri Lanka, even with the lead that they had, they were looking like struggling. But then the man at the crease over there, but Karna Ratne, I would have to say, it's not a yorker actually. The ball is an in-swinger from Rahat Ali, which went on to take the stumps of Karna Ratne. And then it was Angelo Mathews. After that, it was really required a revival job from the Sri Lankan batsman. That came in the form of Angelo Mathews, the Sri Lankan captain, who was joined in by Jahan Mubarak. Jahan Mubarak took his time along with Angelo Mathews. Angelo Mathews continued to, they had to resuscitate the situation, no doubt about it. And that's what they precisely did by grafting their way, with Angelo Mathews really plodding along, blocking the balls well, and only really getting on to any loose stuff that was served to him to actually dispatch it to the boundary. Jahan Mubarak was definitely playing some very, very good strokes, some beautiful drives, and then when the partnership was slowly beginning to get a bit of a momentum there, when the score reached 80, Jahan Mubarak, after playing an innings of 35, became the... In fact, before that, it was Upul Tharanga. Upul Tharanga was along with Angelo Mathews, and that partnership took the score to 80. And Upul Tharanga, he was also looking good. And Upul Tharanga was one who was not wasting any time. He was not the one to really potter around at the crease. He decided that he's going to go for the bowling. In the sense, he's going to play strokes. And that's what he precisely did. He kept on playing his strokes. And in the meanwhile, by doing so, he reached 48 of 47 deliveries with 6 fours, before Upul Tharanga, onto a forward prod, was caught at short leg by Azhar Ali of the bowling of Yasir Shah. Yasir Shah getting his first wicket in the second innings. Upul Tharanga out into the pavilion for 48. And after that, as I said, Angelo Mathews and Jahan Mubarak took the scoring along, and they put on a very, very good partnership of 81 runs before Jahan Mubarak was also a victim of Yasir Shah for 35. And then it was Dinesh Chandimal who came in and offered a much needed support to Angelo Mathews at the other end, as Chandimal played some very good strokes too, but also he was really playing according to the needs of the game and was giving solid support to Angelo Mathews. And then finally Sri Lanka went to safety, one could say, at 228 for 5, 291 runs ahead in the second innings. On the third day, Angelo Mathews was not out on 77 with 6 fours and 1 6, and Chandimal was not out on 39 with 5 fours. And Sri Lanka, as I said, They're recovering from the early blows dealt to them by the Pakistani pace bowlers. I thought it was a pretty looking score at 228 for 5. The bowling, Rahat Ali, as I said, by any stretch of imagination, one could say Rahat Ali was bowling his heart out today. 15 overs, 3 maidens, 58 runs and 2 wickets. Hasan Adil was also on the money, 14 overs, 4 maidens, 1 for 46. Imran Khan couldn't get amongst the wickets, but he still tested the batsman, 10.4 overs, 2 maidens, none for 27. And the reason that Imran Khan bowled 10.4 overs, the reason being rain stopped play, and the third day had to be closed at 228 for 5. Yasir Shah, 25 overs, 4 maidens, 70 runs and 2 wickets, and Azhar Ali, 5 overs, 1 maiden, none for 14. So that is as far as the, as I said, the match is looking interestingly poised. It is really in the balance right now. It's very difficult to say which team, but Sri Lanka are looking to get the edge. But what an enthralling series this has been. We are into the definitely a result in this test series, no doubt about it. 2 more days to go. And the fourth day, one would be hoping that Angelo Mathews and James Chandimal could stretch it as much as possible. And we'll also see whether there are some cracks formed where the spinners could come into the equation. And it's not going to be an easy pitch to bat on for Pakistan, I would say, because the more the runs Sri Lanka score, it's going to become difficult for Pakistan here. Well, from here, I'm leaving here and I'm taking you down to Bangladesh now, to the Mirpur Cricket Ground, where the first T20 of the series was enacted between South Africa and Bangladesh. Bangladesh with a newly found confidence today, so one was really looking forward to it. But South Africans were the ones who actually had the luck of the toss. They won the toss and they decided to bat first. They decided to bat first. A.B. de Villiers, I would say Bangladesh derived early joy the crowd was absolutely behind them as they got a big, big wicket, a big fish, one could say. And Bangladesh decided that they probably knew how the pitch is going to play, so they decided that they are going to go with their spinners. So Mashrafe Murtaza introduced Arafat Sunny into the attack. In fact, the first over was given to Arafat Sunny, the left-arm spinner. And Arafat Sunny was the man who picked up the wicket of A.B. de Villiers. So A.B. de Villiers trying to go over the top, trying to chip the ball over the cover region, was caught by Mashrafe Murtaza, the captain of the bowling for Arafat Sunny for 2. So that made it 2 for 1, and that was a big fish for Bangladesh, one could say. And then Quinton de Kock and Du Plessis were at the mid. Du Plessis was the captain, as you know. Quinton de Kock dispatched a 6 of the bowling of Arafat Sunny as he clubbed him to the stands for a 6. But then it was Nasir Hussain. In fact, it was the and we saw why Bangladesh was doing that. It was pretty good captaincy on the part of Mashrafe Murtaza. He decided, because this particular pitch, let me tell you, it was a difficult pitch to bat on. You had to really wait for your turn there, because the pitch was slow. There was little bounce in the pitch, and the spinners were also getting some turn, but the ball was also keeping low, which was a big factor. And then finally, it was Nasir Hussain who picked up the wicket of Quinton de Kock when he caught by Litton Das for 12. And the South African openers were into the pavilion with the score reading 31 for 2. Du Plessis was there in the middle. And that time, after 6 overs, Shakib Al Hasan and Arafat Sunny and Nasir Hussain bowled. In fact, only after 6 overs, we saw the introduction of the team sensation from Bangladesh. The sensational pace bowler from Bangladesh, Mustafizur Rahman. And Mustafizur Rahman started the first over. It was a good over where he gave away only 2 runs by using his variations very well. But then Du Plessis and Domini were the crease. And then Du Plessis played some very good strokes. He started putting the ball into the gaps. And he definitely, I saw Mustafizur Rahman was bowling impressively, but today he couldn't pick up any wickets. And then Domini was the next wicket to fall. And also I thought Mustafizur Rahman bowled with a bit of, he was a bit unlucky because the ball didn't really carry to the fielder. And then Domini was the next one to go as Arafat Sunny picked up his wicket for 18 of 22 balls with 1-4, which made it 77 for 3. David Miller disappointed by being LBW bowled Shakib Al Hasan for 1. And then it was left to Du Plessis, the captain, and really Rozu to give South Africa a score that they could really defend on, and that was 148 for four. With Duplessis remaining not out on 79 of 61 deliveries, the 8-4s. Really, Rousseau cracking 31 of as many deliveries, of 21 deliveries only, with 2-4s and 2-6s, and South Africa went on to sit on a score of 148 for four of their 20 overs, batting first in this T20 match. Now, the bowling, as I said, the spinners are out with Sunny, 3 overs, no made in 2 for 19, was impressive. Nasir Hussain bowling 4 overs for 37 runs and 1 wicket in his bag. Shakib Hasan bowling 4 overs for 24 runs, 1 wicket. Mustafizur Rahman playing his first match against South Africa, 4 overs, no made and none for 30. I still felt a bit, he was a bit unlucky, because he really, really worked up the South African batsman with his pace variations. Sohag Ghazi, it was good to see him with bowling with a new bowling action, 2 overs, none for 16, and Mashrafa Murtaza, 3 overs, no made and none for 20. Now, Bangladesh were set a target of 149 runs to win the match, and on a slow pitch, it was always going to be difficult, but it was pretty interesting to see what was their approach. Well, unlike Bangladesh, South Africa decided not to go with the spinners, and they decided that they are going to go with the pace bowlers. And the pace bowlers didn't disappoint. The first wicket to go was Tamim Iqbal. Tamim Iqbal was knocked off by Abbott, as Tamim Iqbal trying to pull a delivery, caught by Quinton de Kock for 5, 4 balls, 1. Soumya Sarkar was the one who was trying to hook Kagiso Rabada, and that ended in the hands of Dumini. He was gone for 7, as Bangladesh lost 2 wickets for 13 runs in the second over. The score read 13 for 2 in the second over, and then we saw some introduction of spin coming in with Fungiso, Dumini, and David Weiss, the military medium pace bowler, bowling. And then Shakib Al Hasan and Mushfiqur Rahim decided that they would be able to play their strokes here. They decided to play, but again, I thought, as I said, with the pitch behaving in a very, very different manner. It was a very, very slow pitch to bat on, and it was not easy. But still, I thought Shakib Al Hasan and Mushfiqur Rahim did well to get some boundaries. But then, finally, we saw that David Weiss was the... In fact, Mushfiqur Rahim was the next to go, as the partnership brought the 50 mark for Bangladesh. But then JP Dumini picked up the wicket of Mushfiqur Rahim for 17 of 19 deliveries with 2-4s, which made the score 50 for 3. Sabir Rahman, the big hitter, came in and joined Shakib Al Hasan, but all that he could do was trying to do the famous river sweep that he's known for, but that ended in the hands of the wicketkeeper Quinton de Kock, the bowling of Dumini, for 4, so he was gone. So it made it 56 for 4, and then they lost Nasir Hussain, who was caught by Rosu of the bowling of Fungiso for 1, and it was Shakib Al Hasan at the other end who was at the other end, and the hopes were there for Bangladesh when Shakib Al Hasan was at the crease. But then Shakib Al Hasan's wicket was also gone, and this wicket was plucked up by David Weiss, the military medium pace bowler, as he picked up Shakib Al Hasan for 26 of 30 deliveries with 1-4 and 1-6, and then 71 for 6, it was always going to be difficult. Litton Das, the impressive player against India, was making his T20 debut, but all that he could do is to stay there. But unfortunately, there was no support forthcoming for him from the Bangladeshi tailenders, as Mashrafe Murtaza was out to Rabada for 5, or 4 balls with 1-4. Sohag Ghazi was run out for 3, Arafat Sunny was not out on 1, and Mustafizur Rahman was cleaned up by Parnell for 1, leaving Litton Das, and then Litton Das himself had to succumb, because, as I said, the pressure was building on him to score runs, and in that effort, he also succumbed, getting out to David Weiss, as De Villiers held the catch. He was gone for 22 of 26 balls, and Bangladesh, as I said, they were all out for the lowest total that in a T20 that they have made at home, and they were rolled out for 96. With South Africa in the first match of the T20 series registering a victory by 52 runs at Mirpur. Let's have a bowling. Let's look at the bowling figures of the Bangladeshis. Of the South Africans. As I said, the second string pace attack in the absence of Dale Steyn went on Philander and Monty Morkel, and I thought they did a fantastic job. Kyle Abbott, 2 overs no made in 1 for 10. Kagiso Rabada, 3 overs no made in 28 runs and 2 wickets, packing a lot of pace there. Parnell bowling 2.5 overs, no maiden, 1 for 12. The multi-medium pace of David Bees, 3 overs, no maiden, 12 runs on 2 wickets. Fungiso, 4 overs, 1 for 21, the left-arm spinner. And JP Duminy, 4 overs, no maiden, 2 for 11. And the South African captain, Faf du Plessis, taking the Man of the Match award. But I thought it was a good match. And Bangladesh should be hoping that in the next, I'm going to have to wait and see what is the pitch preparation as far as the second T20 is concerned. Well, as I said, this was a slow pitch, but again, it was a real test of real batting skills there. And I thought South Africans were the one who stood up the test well and got a victory for them. And got a victory, I mean, started off this particular series against Bangladesh with a victory under the belt. Well, dear fans and subscribers, that really, really brings an end to this Cricket Happening show of mine this on a Sunday. Hope you all loved it and enjoyed it. And please continue to enjoy this daily cricket show as long as it lasts. And your host, Ram, will be there as usual tomorrow on my daily Cricket Happening show on Monday. And I will be talking about that enthralling day's place coming up on the fourth day, which is definitely, definitely going to say what is going to be the outcome, which is the team which is going to win this particular test match. Well, that really, really says it all and also ends up my Cricket Happening show this on a Sunday. And till such time, I see you all, dear friends and subscribers. It's goodbye from your host, Ram. Thank you.